Internal Revenue Service IRS Tax News. An overview of the Taxpayer Bill of Rights. Taxpayer Bill of Rights. Is it just me, or does it seem like this Bill of Rights has taken a sharp left? I mean, if we don't watch out, we'll end up with a Bill of Lefts. Which, of course, is just another way of saying communism. But you know how they like to come up with new words for stuff? Because, like, if you rename stuff, the stuff is no longer stupid. Instead, it's ambiguous, and ambiguity can be worked with. Ambiguous stuff can be cool. But wait a second, how can the ambiguous thing be cool now? The ambiguity is in name only. The actual thing being named, having been universally declared stupid like 5 seconds ago. I mean, honestly, like, these dang lunatics are just about to name Jabba the Hutt Miss America. I'm sorry, that's stupid. No, Jabba the Hutt is no longer a fat reptilian-like mobster. He's an upstanding, reputable, and honored beauty queen. It's like, you know, why not just make Miss America out of the freaking Rancor? Crying out loud, it's silly. The Bill of Lefts declares that all your money will be redistributed toward the noble cause of pandering to crazy, self-destructive, short-sighted people. So as to further the equally noble cause of giving us a reason to take all your money. May the Bill of Lefts live long, prosper, and, of course, plunder. But first a joke. Politics is crazy these days, I swear.
Why, hello, George. I thought you'd be in church praying for a full return to mental health.
I mean, you get a guy like John Fetterman, or to a slightly lesser extent, President Biden, who has literally lost the capacity to process speech.
Putin's kleptocracy. Yeah.
And they're still somehow, like, politically invincible.
Do you have a name?
My name is Gladiator.
I mean, like, they're just standing there, seemingly helpless, feeble, and corrupt, but somehow politically untouchable. Honestly, like, some normal dude looking at this spectacle would think, like, hey, if that mentally, physically, and morally unfit guy can withstand the political blows, surely a relatively young, healthy, actually somewhat successful dude, like myself, could do the same, right?
I must find if I too possess this special skill.
Should we keep going, Sign? Hey, whoa, easy. We should wait a second or so. Hey, guys, come on. Oh, well. Hey, wait. He did say the...
It's pretty
still.
Maybe it's time.
Honestly, it almost makes you think there's some kind of outside nefarious force at work here. An ominous power, one we often refer to simply as the dark side.
Everything that has transpired has done so according to my design. It was I who allowed the Alliance to know the location of the shield generator.
Or... it's more euphemistic label, the press.
They have served the dark will of Persian kings for 500 years. Eyes as dark as night, teeth filed to fangs, soulless.
IRS Tax Tip 2022-174, November 14th, 2022. By law, all taxpayers have fundamental rights when they're interacting with the IRS. It's important that all taxpayers know and understand their rights. The Taxpayer Bill of Rights, there's a link to that here, presents these rights in 10 categories. For full official details about each right, visit the links below. You got the right to be informed. Taxpayers have the right to know what they need to do to comply with the tax law. This seems basic, but obviously if you're in a situation where you don't have any instructions, you don't know what to do, then you can't actually do what it is that they want you to do, and there's no way that you can get out of any kind of problems if that were the situation. So there's a link to that one. The right to quality service. There's a link to that here. Taxpayers have the right to receive prompt, courteous, and professional assistance when working with the IRS, and the freedom to speak to a supervisor about inadequate service. So obviously, same kind of process applies. They try to mimic, you would think, in like a business situation where you have market pressures. In that case, of course, the good service is typically driven by competition, and you typically can be able to, you know, take a level up and see if you could talk to someone's supervisor and so on. The government entities try to mirror that kind of thing, possibly sometimes, you know, better times than others, because of course, again, they don't really have that market structure. So private organizations, or not-for-profit organizations, I mean, have to strive a little bit harder to try to keep up their quality of service, given the fact that there's an absence of that market pressure. So the right to pay no more than the correct amount of tax. There's a link to that here. Taxpayers have the right to pay only the amount of tax legally due, including interest, penalties, and to have the IRS apply all tax payments properly. So clearly, when you're doing your taxes or figuring the taxes, we want to be able to figure the taxes to the extent that we are in accordance with the law, and then paying the least amount as possible. You can pay more tax, of course, if you want to, but that's more like charity rather than the paying of the taxes. And this is an interesting point, because oftentimes when you look at arguments about taxes and tax law, people call things like loopholes. There's a loophole here, there's a loophole there. And you can call it a loophole, but that's kind of implies that the people that are filing their taxes are doing something nefarious, when in actuality, if the law says that that's what the law says and you have a right to pay the least amount possible, then it's not really the taxpayer that's doing something nefarious. They're just paying their taxes in accordance with the law. And if the law is not right, then you should change the law, would be the general idea if there is an issue with it. In any case, the right to challenge the IRS position and be heard. There's a link to that here. So taxpayers have the right to object to formal IRS actions or proposed actions and provide justification with additional documentation. Now, obviously, when you oppose the IRS, you can't really just say, well, I don't think you should be able to collect taxes. You can kind of say that when you vote, try to vote for somebody that's going to represent you to lower the taxes. But obviously here we're talking about the law has been set. We're going to be in compliance with the law. Now, we don't want a situation, it would be a tyrannical type of situation, right? If the IRS can just interpret the law any way they want and then impose it, and you can't argue against it, right? The law says I owe $1,000, you charged me $5,000, and you gave no reason under the tax code as to why the tax code says you owe me $5,000 and you said $5,000. That kind of thing you can argue against, in alignment, of course, with the tax code. So if your position is in alignment with the tax code. So the right to appeal an IRS decision and an independent forum. There's a link to that here. Taxpayers are entitled to a fair and impartial administrative appeal of most IRS decisions, including certain penalties. So clearly, if the IRS is taking a strong position on a particular item, you can argue against it. Again, the tax code being the thing that you're arguing that you are in alignment or not. Now, obviously, it doesn't seem quite fair if you have two people arguing, or two entities arguing, about whether or not something is correct in accordance with the law, the tax code, to have the arbiter be the IRS, right? So you'd think in some way you would need to be appealing to some process that's outside of the two entities, you know, involved in the argument and an appeals kind of process in general would be kind of like an idea. So the right to finality, there's a link to that here. Taxpayers have the right to know the maximum amount of time they have to challenge an IRS position and the maximum amount of time the IRS must audit a particular tax year or collect a tax debt. So obviously we need to be able to know, you know, what is my recourse period in order to take action. And when you're filing your tax returns, you're doing a voluntary, well, you're supposed to be presenting your information to the IRS in terms of how much you owe on the form 1040. And the question then is going to be, well, how long do I have to sit and kind of agonize or worry about them potentially coming back and questioning my auditing me? Can they come back like 20 years later? Generally, no. Generally, there's a statute of limitations. But if you have certain situations like fraud or something like that, then they might, you know, those limitations could change a bit. So in any case, you could dive into that in more detail. The right to privacy. Taxpayers have the right to expect that any IRS inquiry, examination, or enforcement action will comply with the law and be no more intrusive than necessary. So clearly when the IRS is kind of digging into our finances, that's kind of a personal, you know, type of thing to some degree. You would think that they wouldn't be tweeting it out there or using kind of blackmailish type behaviors or anything like that with our financial conditions and whatnot. Generally, you would think that would be an idea for a right to privacy. So the right to confidentiality, link to that here. The right, taxpayers have the right to expect that their tax information will remain confidential. So again, you got sensitive information there. You would think that they wouldn't be tweeting out your information, although it seems like there seems to be leaks sometimes with famous people with tax documents and whatnot. But you would think that you're not supposed to do that. It's sensitive. It's just between you and the government. You know, anyways, the right to retain representation. There's a link to that here. Taxpayers have the right to retain an authorized representative of their choice to represent them in their interactions with the IRS. So again, if the IRS was to take a position that you don't agree with, then you know you want to have someone else possibly that can be interpreting the law. It's a position that they're taking that you don't agree with in alignment with the tax code. So then you want someone possibly to represent you in a similar way as you might be representing in a legal type of situation or another kind of legal type of situation, in other words. So the right to a fair and just tax system, it's kind of a broad one. There's a link to that here. Taxpayers have the right to expect fairness from the tax system. This includes considering all facts and circumstances that might affect their liabilities, ability to pay, or provide information timely. So there's a link to that item here. If you want to dive into any of those in more detail, you can. There'll be a link to this in the description.